Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, Christina can decide if she wants to use it or not. So. I'm Carolyn Waters. I'm head librarian. Welcome to the magical, wonderful world of miniature books. I should say, as a rather small person, or at least shorter than the average, I'm pretty fascinated by anything that's smaller than it should be. Mini pencils, mini staplers, anything that's smaller. So miniature books are really fantastic. My mother always said, good things come in small packages. She was trying to make me feel better about my size. But it is true. So I want to introduce Christina Amato, who's going to give her a talk today. Christina is the library's book conservator. She joined us a year ago in January. And she's worked in the conservation field for the past 10 years. She's worked previously at the New York Academy of Medicine, the Folger Shakespeare Library, Harvard University, and the Boston Athenaeum, her sister institution up in Massachusetts. She trained as a bookbinder at the North Bennett Street School in Boston. And she's been making miniature books for as long as she's been working in the conservation field. She writes, illustrates, and binds them in limited editions. And she's lectured on the subject for the Miniature Book Society. Did you even know there was such a thing? And now you do. And she's also lectured at the Guild of Bookworkers. She's the winner of the 2012 Miniature Book Society Distinguished Book Award for her 1.5-inch high book, Swells and Spines, or The Man Who Bound at Sea. So please welcome Christina Amato.
Thank you, Carolyn. Can you hear me okay? I have a really kind of squeaky voice, so maybe I will use the microphone. Okay. Thank you for your kind introduction. Tonight, I'm going to talk a little bit about what exactly a miniature book is, and just some of their pros and cons, and notable miniature books throughout history, and also special considerations for caring for them. And I would encourage you to interject if you want to. I actually kind of like to be interrupted during talks, because otherwise, I don't know, it gets boring for me if you guys don't interact sometimes. It's a little weird having a slideshow of miniature books because the whole point of them is that they're small. And when they're projected, you lose that, right? So they look like they might be any size. So I'll try to tell you the sizes if I can. Some of them, the pictures I have don't have sizes listed, which I think is kind of crazy, but there you go. You'll notice sometimes I get it in centimeters, sometimes inches. I hope that's not confusing. I just didn't have the energy to do the conversions, so I hope you can forgive me for that. Before I get started on that, I'll tell you a little bit about myself. As Carolyn said, I'm a book conservator here at the library, and I actually know quite a few book conservators who are fans of miniature books, and I think it makes complete sense because we like obsessing over tiny details, like the molecular weight of our adhesives or trace amounts of metals and water. That photo of me in a microscope, I have to admit, is staged. I wasn't really looking at anything real. In the picture to the right, I'm using a tiny piece of Japanese paper to fix a paper tear, and something seemingly as minor as using a 1 or 2 gram piece of paper, which is almost indistinguishable, make a huge difference in the lifespan of a piece of paper. So it pays to be obsessed with details when you're a conservator. It's also helpful when you live in a tiny Brooklyn apartment to focus on making tiny books. This is a picture of my studio, which is about the size of probably that table. I like to make books in my spare time, so in addition to being a conservator, I'm also a bookbinder. And I just want to note, I don't know if any of you collect miniature books, but if you're interested in collecting something, you can get a really major collection and still only need a shoebox to hold it all. So living in New York City is something to think about. I just have a few pictures of some of my books, and then I'll stop talking about me. As Carolyn said, I write and illustrate my own books, generally in editions of 20. I prefer to work about 1.5 inches tall, which is kind of large in the miniature book world. There's just the interior of one of my books. This one is a book I wrote about how to make miniature books, and it's all sold out, so I don't have one here today. Okay, so enough about me. The question I get asked the most, which I think is surprising, but let's just tackle it on and get it over with, which is, what exactly is a miniature book? What's the criteria? And I can sum that up for you in one slide. A miniature book is under 3 inches in every dimension. That is all. End of talk. In Europe, it can go up to 4 or 5 inches, but for the purposes of my work, I like to keep it to 3. But for the truly obsessed, there are categories of miniature books that you can lose yourself in, and I hope I'll write this down because it's really important. There is the macro miniature, which is 3 to 5 inches, or 3 to 4 inches, which some would say is not even a true miniature book. There is the plain miniatures, which are between 1 and 3 inches in height. There is the micro miniature, which is a 1/4 inch to 1 inch in height. And finally, the ultra micro miniature, which is less than 1/4 inch in height. Dollhouse miniatures also make a big part of the market, and they are at the scale of 1 inch to 1 foot. I don't know if that makes sense. So for every foot, they're small. So there are a lot of drawbacks to miniature books. I find a lot of bookbinders don't like them, which I find shocking, but I can deal with some controversy, so I'm gonna talk about that a little bit. It's true, they don't make very good blank books. They're a little hard to write in. They can be hard to read. Sometimes it just gets silly. This is, as you can see from the title, it's written on a halved poppy seed. And I probably should have had a laser pointer, but the pages themselves are the little white things on that gold square. So the poppy seed is the white, like, kind of legume-looking shape there, and the pages are about 6 per gold piece of gold. And apparently it is, the first book is a list of masters who managed to shoe a flea, and the second book is just the Russian alphabet. Also, it can be tempting to take shortcuts when you're making miniature books because they're so small. This book I actually have on the table over there if you want to look at it. It's a beautiful little Bible. It was printed just fantastically with a lot of detail, but they bound it by using a staple. So we can look at it later, but it doesn't open more than that, so you actually can't read it. So I kind of wonder what the point is. Oh, there's
the whole Bible? The whole New Testament?
I believe it is. Yeah. But you can see the staple there. It's not going to open well. It's kind of a lazy structure. Also, they have a reputation for not opening well and not closing well, and that reputation can be deserved. However, I'm trying to change attitudes about miniature books. If you look at them throughout history, I was giving away these buttons for a while. If there's an interest, I will make more because they need to be stood up for. But if you look at miniature books throughout history, you'll see that there are many examples that were not only useful, but exquisitely crafted. So we're gonna talk about miniature books throughout history a little bit, but the thing about them is, as a category, they follow the history of regular books. It's just that they're smaller in scale. So, for example, when Babylonians were making clay tablets, They were also making miniature clay tablets. The one on the left is from 2000 BC. The one on the right is from about 2000 BC too. And they are about a little over an inch to an inch and a half tall. And these were precursors to the codex. They were used for keeping track of trades. So it would be something that a tradesperson could carry in the pocket. So it actually was very useful. I imagine having a big, heavy lump of clay to carry around wouldn't be the most useful thing. So, and they were cute. When illuminated manuscripts were being made in medieval times, they were also making miniature medieval manuscripts. I don't have an exact size for this one, but I think it is a little larger. It's probably around 3 inches. This is Hours of the Virgin, so it wasn't the whole Bible. It's a little hard to see because they're very small. The same goes for incunabulum. I don't know if you know what incunabula are. They are books that were printed before 1501, European books, before the invention of the printing press by Gutenberg. So there was just a very narrow space of time when they were making books and printing them, but they were making them to look like handwritten books because that was the aesthetic they were used to. And there are only about a dozen that still exist in the whole world. And this one is from Venice from 1475. And in fact, since the invention of the printing press, apprentices were traditionally taught to work in miniature to hone their skills, because the thought was if you could figure out how to do that, then you were good. This is a copy of the Divine Commedia from Galileo, I think.
Dante.
Thank you. I was going to say Dante. I really was, and I second-guessed myself. And evidently, cutting the type for this book caused serious injury to the eyesight of both the compositor and the corrector, and took 1 month to print 30 pages, 30 very small pages. I think they had this at the Grolier Club for a while. Apparently, maybe you can understand this, four letters, so four of like individual letters could fit on the head of a pin. Just to give you an idea of scale, I know it's hard when it's blown up like this. That looks like a British, not a dime, small British coin, and that's the book on top of it. So it is quite small. If I had it here, it would be more impressive. Okay, now this is kind of a sad story, because these books were from 1952. They were called the smallest books in the world. They're about 5 by 5 millimeters. Each page was printed on one piece of four-point type. And to visualize that, maybe after I'm done talking, I brought in the smallest type I have is a four-point type, so it's like half this size. And each page, you'll just have to come up and look at it. I don't know how to describe it. But the sad thing is, it is so small. I actually have a copy of one of these books, and I cannot find it. I think I might have inhaled it accidentally.
You might have what?
Inhaled it? Who knows? It might have slipped under.
Well,
I might have vacuumed it. It might have blown out the window.
Throw away your vacuum.
I was going to bring it in for you, but it seems to be lost. Okay, now this I think is a successful slide. This is from the year 2000. It was printed in China, or in Tokyo, and it is 0.95 by 0.95 millimeters. And the book itself, I'll just have to, it's not that center thing, it's that little tiny speck on the left of the little circle in the middle. So that was as close a picture as they could get. But, so you do kind of wonder what the point is at this stage, like probably no one's gonna actually read it. But A big part of the miniature book market is books for children. And it makes sense as children are miniature. They make miniature books for children. Probably some of the most famous miniature books were made by children, which are the Bronte books. I don't know if any of you have heard of them. They've been in the news lately because Harvard has been digitizing them and has put some of them online so you can look at them in their entirety.
Where is that exhibit at the Morgan? Library?
They've been kind of in the news lately. So there are only about 20 that survive, made by Charlotte Bronte and her brother Branwell. And they pieced them together using scraps that they had around the house. They're each around 2.5 by 5 centimeters large. I guess you can get a sense because that person's hand was in the picture. I won't say anything about the white gloves. I'm not a fan, but you'll see them a lot in this lecture.
Why are you a fan?
Okay, you asked. So
we hope this picture.
It's true. White gloves they just impede your tactile sensation, so you're more likely to damage a book wearing white gloves, especially a little tiny book. Going through the pages when you have these big clunky gloves on your hand, they also attract dirt, and so they end up getting more dirt on the pages than if you weren't wearing them. Today, people recommend that you just wash your hands carefully before you handle a book. You'll do more damage with white gloves than you will with the grease on your hands, trust me. Good. It's different if it's with photographs and some metal objects, but for books, the rule of thumb is no white gloves, and I'm really happy I said that because that transitions perfectly into the next category, which is thumb Bibles. They started to appear in the early 17th century as a way of introducing religion to children in easily digestible bite-sized pieces. They were paraphrases of Bible stories edited for children, and they were generously illustrated, usually. This book is from the Learly Library, and it's French. I can try to say it if you want me to, but it's a French book, and from 1800. In the early 19th century, they started making entire miniature libraries for children. They were often in the form of a miniature bookcase-shaped box filled with identically bound little books. They were often about royalty, history, natural history, and religion. I think you'll find religion is a common theme in early miniature books.
The 3 inches or less?
Oh, yes.
Seems so surprising to me because my experience is children are all thumbs, so how is this better for them? Tiny book.
It's a good question. I guess maybe in the past, children were just more dexterous than children today. Actually, I do see a lot of little tiny needle points that children used to do, and I can imagine today. So I'll just say children are getting less dexterous. The case on the left is called the infant's own bookcase, and on the right is the infant's cabinet of the cries of London. And I just included it because I liked the title. Probably one of the most famous examples of books for children is Queen Mary's Dollhouse. So you have to imagine this isn't really for children because it's so spectacular. To give you an idea of the size, you can see someone putting some books back in up there. It had a collection of 200 miniature books bound in different leathers, they're all hand bound, with individual tiny book plates for each one. Each author who contributed to the library was sent a request along with a tiny blank book. So I believe a lot of them were handwritten for Queen Mary. Most of the people who were sent these blank books accepted and returned them. Just to give you an idea of size. The book on the bottom is 1.6 inches by 1.4 inches. And that was handwritten by the famous cartoonist of the day, Faux-Poix. So, I think I have left out a slide, but there are some pretty notable books from history that were in miniature format that you might not think were in miniature format. The Emancipation Proclamation was originally produced as a miniature in 1862. There were 1 million copies distributed to Union soldiers so that we could carry them and distribute them. So it had a really good reason for being miniature. And of course, it looks giant projected on the screen, but that book is 2 1/4 by 3 1/4 inches high. So it's almost a true, I guess it's a macro miniature. And you can actually, I saw today, buy it online for a mere $22,000. Supposedly, Napoleon used to travel with a miniature library. It seems a little sketchy to me. I've seen pictures of this throughout the internet, but no real, the source is a little fuzzy, but supposedly this was his traveling library. This is Anne Boleyn's Book of Songs. It is 4 centimeters high by 3 centimeters. As you can see, it contains a portrait of Henry VIII. She purportedly handed this book to one of her maids of honor when she was on the scaffold moments before her execution in 1536. And it was actually pretty common in the Middle Ages for small volumes among literate women in particular, particularly books of hours. The small dimensions made them lighter to carry and show off. Often they wore them as jewelry hanging from a chain. You can see this one was probably worn as jewelry because it has the loop for a chain to go through. They were also fabulously decorated much of the time. So how to care for miniature books. Probably don't hit them with a hammer like I did this book, but that was just so I would have a slide to show you guys. For the most part, taking care of miniature books is pretty much the same as taking care of larger books. So try to keep them in a stable environment, meaning not attics and basements. Ideally in a coolish room, room temperature below, and dry, so 35% humidity is a good idea. Away from direct light. As we said, don't wear white gloves, please, while you're handling them. The problem with miniature books is really one of storage. As I found out this morning, they're easy to lose, and they can get crushed on the bookshelf in between larger books or slip in cracks. So there are a few good solutions to this, though. If you're looking to just store one special miniature book, you can have a custom box made. I made this box when I worked at the Boston Athenaeum for an artist book they have there. And it's a good idea to build them out so they're the box in the size of a regular book. But it has a little pop-up compartment to fit the miniature book in so that you can get it out of the box. If you have a larger collection of miniature books, this photo is from the University of Virginia's Lindemann collection of over 15,000 miniature books. And what they've done is use standard size pre-made boxes and just pack them out with archival tissue. And they've also barcoded each book so they can keep track of them. Is kind of a genius idea. And we saw these Bronte books earlier. What Harvard has done is made one large sunken mat for the book, so they each have their own little compartments, and they used a very thin piece of thread so that they're essentially sewn on to the board so they don't fall out. But so they're protected, but it's also something that can be used to display the books if they need to. They can just pop that whole thing into a frame. If you have just a smallish collection of miniature books and unlimited funds, you can invest in a piece of custom-made furniture. This cabinet was made by for the binder Louis Genet's collection of 68 miniature books, and it's now owned by the Rochester Institute of Technology for some reason. My solution, if you also have a moderate amount of miniature books and you don't want to spend a lot of money, is to hoard free samples of boxes from the Hollinger Metal Edge Company. I have a few on that table if you want to look at them. They give them out with their business cards in them, and they're the perfect size for miniature books. It's very satisfying. If you want to learn more about miniature books, the Miniature Book Society is sort of the place to go, and I think it's just mbs.org. It's a good place if you want to know where to buy them, or you have a collection you want to appraise. They have dealers that they list on their website. Also, it's I don't work for them, but it's an extremely good price. It's like, I think, $40 a year, and you get adorable miniature books in the mail regularly. They just send you free, well, not free, but they send you stuff. They also have the best swag of any conference I've ever gone to. I have these up front, and one that I went to Boston, I had a bag with little miniature book plates with my name on them and tiny little metal bookends, which are up there. I don't know why you wouldn't join. If you're looking for storage supplies for miniature books, there are a few places you could go to buy archival housing. There's Hollinger Metal Edge, and you can, of course, enable to get some samples. That would be perfect. They also have smallish boxes. I think they're for microfiche, which work pretty good for miniature books. Demco is General Library Resources. They also have some boxes in there. If you want some custom-made boxes, Talus, which is actually located in Brooklyn, will make very simple custom boxes. So I don't think they would make special compartments or anything like that, but actually they might. So thank you very much, and I just want to give a shout out to the Miniature Books Society's traveling exhibit. We were originally going to have it here as part of, well, I was going to talk about that as well, which would have been nice because it is hard to see in a slide exactly how tiny something is. But apparently in its last venture to a library, it was damaged beyond repair. So they're fixing the cabinet now, and hopefully we will get it soon. They didn't give a good idea of when it will be fixed, but they tend to be kind of casual with the Miniature Book Society, so it could be some time. So that is all. I have some miniature books up front if you want to look at them. I have some of my own books and some that I've collected over time. You'll see that a lot of miniature books were produced as novelty items, so they were given away at banks and things like that, instead of lollipops, I guess, for kids. A lot of Bible stories and things like that, but you can feel free to go up and take a look at them if you'd like. Does anyone have any questions?
How many do you have in your own collection?
Oh gosh, I don't know.
Hundreds?
No, I don't have hundreds. I'm more of a maker than a collector. If something's cute, I'll collect it. The people who are collectors of miniature books can be very fanatical about it, and will have. I went to one woman's house who had thousands and thousands. She had books written by Picasso and books going back, you know, 1,000 years. the earliest books, and so what I collect is pretty modest in comparison to that. But I've probably made hundreds throughout the years.
Well, that's a good number, yeah. Are some of them homemade books? Like, you're making books yourself. Are some mm-hmm. of the books you collect handmade by
I will occasionally buy a book from another artist, usually out of feelings of guilt if they bought one of mine.
How is the print created?
The print, and that reminds me, you should come up and see this four-point print. For me, I use a computer, but how they used to cut type in the old days, they would often cast type. So I believe early on we would probably use something like the lost wax process, where you carve something and make a mold of it, out of wax, make a mold of it and burn out the wax and pour in brass, or a lot of times it's a high lead content. This actually has this is mostly lead and some other materials. So someone would sit there and carve out of wax. I can't even imagine the Dante book from earlier, how, with their little tools, and I don't know if they had glasses back then, but I'm sure they didn't have a lot of light. They must have just done it during the day. But if you can look at how small four-point type is, to imagine carving, and having the casting be successful, because you get little air bubbles and things like that, so.
Faces when trying to get in touch with the reason for it, and that they've mm-hmm. actually been used to be the couple that I looked at, which is the real thing.
Yeah,
I think
it depends. There's a whole, I mean, there's a bunch of different reasons for them. For mine, I make them about an inch and a half tall because I think I want people to read them. I think you can still handle them, but I think often you get down to that poppy seed book that I showed you. It's really just to do it, just to like say you did it. I guess because I think, is it IBM who made their logo out of individual molecules or something? So it's like if you need an electron microscope to see it. I'm not as interested in that, because that's more to just say that you did it. That's people who are interested in record breaking, you know. I think a lot of times it is just to be cute. Like if you look at dollhouse books, a lot of times they're blank inside. They're just covers to put in your little house.
I understand, but the ones with printed ones, mm-hmm. the people carry around magnifying glasses?
Sometimes, some of them come with magnifying glasses. I think some of the miniature books that people use in medieval times, books of hours and things like that, they were on the larger side of miniature books that we would think of as miniature books. They might have even been up to 5 inches tall. So it really was for portability, like the Emancipation Proclamation. It really was for portability. So occasionally it did have a real reason for being that small, but sometimes it's just because
of the heat. You mentioned two universities, University of Virginia and Harvard. Have they ever had exhibits of their miniature books?
I don't know about Harvard. I think the University of Virginia must have, because they have such a significant collection.
Yeah,
another university, if you're interested, is the Lilly Library, which I think it's in, I could be wrong, but I think it's in Minnesota. The Lilly Library? Mm-hmm. I'm not sure. They have
Indiana.
A...
And then it would be
in Indiana.
It would be in Indiana.
Yeah. They, if you win the Miniature Book Society's award, they take that book. So they have all of the winners, and they also just have a large historical collection of books. The Grolier Club has had fantastic exhibits, miniature books.
Well, I just saw one.
They still had, I think they might have had
that.
Well,
they had one
working recently not on the miniature books, but on how books are used in other ways, as kitchen tools, as art. And I was going to ask you about you, and it was just like last year.
There are things that, and that I find hard not to collect too as a bookbinder.
Well, that was the sense I got.
Like book shaped salt and pepper holders are absolutely irresistible to me.
Did you see that?
I did not. You know, I feel really guilty.
That was a, I'll stop. But it's a very good catalog, I think.
But the Girl Nerd Club has a fantastic catalog of miniature books of design bindings. It wasn't that long ago. I was going to bring in the book of design bindings for you all to look at, but it's heavy and it's large, and I didn't want to bring it out subway. So
it's behind scaffolding now. It's very hard to get to, but they have great stuff.
They've had some fantastic miniature books.
What were you going to bring in?
They have a catalog of design bindings, the Girl Nerd Club design miniature bindings, which are astonishing.
Is it for sale?
I think I bought it pretty recently. Yeah. So it's probably still for sale. I mean, it's a big hardcover book, which is why I didn't bring it.
Well, I would think that would be
heavy. But it was a pretty reasonable price too, I think. It was like $68.
Oh, I'm gonna go look at the books.
I looked with the special collections library, and we were desperate. Should we keep bringing you these like 6-inch tall books and say, this isn't it? No, that's not quite. Though I think we should start collecting miniature books. But we will, in theory, have this little exhibit coming through as soon as it's better. It's very sad. I know, I was so, and I asked them to send it this month because it's my birthday this month. It's like a little special thing for me, but it was not to be.
And how large is that, what we're looking at here?
That is about, it would fit on that table, I'll say, a little smaller than that table. Uh-huh. And so they have examples of historical structures in there, and also the winners of their design competition is in there, and it's just really cool. We'll get to see it soon, though, I hope.
Thank you.
I'm just going to show you the Morgan Library had an exhibit on Charles Bronson. There's the left Morgan has.
Probably
need a magnifying glass. I'm surprised that it's from 1940, so it's 1940.
Sorry,
Well, I was sort of saying,
oh yeah,
this is
that's very nimble.
So those are, I believe, 4-point types. So, like, if you look at this type, that's a lot of
points.
I'm not going to. And also, one of the books in the slide, they printed an entire page on.
But compared to these, that's...
Oh, that's lovely.
That's a good idea.
Robert's Rams. She's not doing it anymore.
It sounds familiar. I run to a lot of people in the literature world because it's a small, little close thing. Well, it takes as much time to make a little book as a big book, which I'm more tired
of.
No, I see the appeal. Because now I find ones I can read.
Hey,
this is the one I had looked at before, and there's just no way.
Well, it's a printed book, but it's just, it's how they put it together. You can't open it.
Yeah, but you can see it even if you open it.
Your book is just amazing.
Oh, thank you.
The binding of it that's selling.
This is that is actually stingray skin.
This is absolutely beautiful. Totally love it. I love it. Now I get to print.
That's why I like to, because I want them to be legible. Yeah, this is, I don't even know what size tank that is, but that's a little pretty old.
What kind of paper?
I use just a whole can of worms. I had a hard time finding a paper I like. I just use a finish. Is machine-made paper too? Because there are some really nice handmade papers, but if you're going to do addition, it gets really expensive, and they don't always print very well on computers. So I use a machine-made paper. In the past, something like this was made with Bible paper, which worked really well because it's so thin, but they don't make Bible paper like this anymore. It's just, I don't know how they did it. It was really, really thin, but opaque and printed well, and you just can't get it anymore.
I have Bibles like this. Not that old, but better.
Yeah, I've tried. I ordered some from London, which ended up being such trash. I used it for reason paper. But,
well, that's the beautiful little dial.
Did you make that one?
No, this one I don't even remember how I got this one. This is an older one. This is let's see if it has a date.
How many would you make a food story?
I usually do about 20.
Uh-huh.
That's a lot. I usually start to get bored around 15. Mm-hmm.
And then you sell them at fairs?
Yeah, I've sold them at, like, the Miniature Book Society has an annual conference that you can go to, and collectors go there to buy things.
When I grew up, my father had a lot of these Lilliput dictionaries.
Mm-hmm.
Are those considered miniature books or not too big?
I think they are. If it's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah.
Like this little, this is a little dictionary.
So they're a tiny bit bigger than that, I think. So they might be about this size.
Yeah,
it's,
I mean, that is just a miniature too.
Do you ever make how to make a miniature book and a slight larger size that?
Nope, I do make it this size, yeah. This I just did for fun. But usually I make them about that size.
And you sell them?
Uh-huh.
But the how to make the miniature book, you make those.
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
What a wonderful present. It's fun to give people things they would never find themselves. Do you write the stories too?
Mm-hmm. Nope, that is from the bot.
This is beautiful.
That was happy.
Oh, well, we're talking new. We have the new ones.
No, good. I've never seen you. Despite the... That's a little separate to the groups. It's just vibrant toothpicks. The circuit is helpful.
There are also a lot of Shakespeare's. A lot of Shakespeare. Sure.